This is the Phantom from the World Wide West. Welcome to Phantom Radio, presented by the Cable Company, the number one lane maintenance company in the world. For all of your lane maintenance needs, including 24-hour technical support, you can always rely on the Cable Company. So go to Kegel.net. Well, Phantom fans, this week's special guest is a man that was here with us 2 weeks ago, and his is one of the most interesting stories in all of bowling. And depending on who you talk to, he could have been one of the greatest bowlers of all time. His achievements as a youth bowler and as an action bowler on the East Coast are legendary. At the age of 15, he spent the entire summer with a teacher and developed a dominating game by the time he was 18. And by the age of 23, he was voted the two-time Metropolitan Player of the Year and the Eastern PBA Regional Player of the Year, which led him to bowl in the prestigious Firestone Tournament of Champions. Then things started to change, so much so that there's already been a documentary about him, a book that's about to be published, and Hollywood has shown interest about making a movie. He's been a gifted bowler, but says he has a greater gift to share. So here again with us is Bob Perry Perzicki. Hello, Bob, and welcome back to the show.
Oh, thank you, Lenny. It's great to be here. I looked forward to this show right after the other one ended. It was great, and I'm really happy to be here.
Well, I thought it was great too, Pards, and I really appreciate you taking the time to be back here with us again on Phantom Radio, and I've got a lot more to talk with you about, so let's just get right to it. You know, the book that we talked a little bit about last time you were here is about to be released. So my question is everything on schedule, and if so, when will it be available?
It'll be available tomorrow, November 7th. We're releasing it on ebook, and we're going to release it on Amazon.com.
Ah, fantastic.
November 7th.
November 7th, it's going to be available, and you say Amazon.com, and is that the only place our listeners can get a copy at this point?
Yeah, at this time, that is the only place. The ebook will be available, and that's a little cheaper, but the book itself is going to be released on Amazon.com on Thursday. So that's where they can pick it up at this time. In the future,
right,
We'll let you know if something's changed.
Yeah, I'm going to stay in touch with you because I'm sure there's going to be a lot of outlets for the distribution of this book because it's awesome. So at this point in time, starting tomorrow, November 7th, it'll be available on Amazon.com. And give us the name of the book again so these people, my listeners, can go there and get it right away.
The name of the book is called Bowling for the Mob.
Bowling for the Mob. What a great title. Unbelievable. Well, you know, Farts, I know that this is going to be a huge seller based on the feedback that I got from your last appearance here. And the response I got from our listeners about that show was perhaps the most emails I've ever received from any show in the 12 years we've been doing this. And I also got several phone calls from friends and listeners about you. And they all wanted to tell me a story or two about you. And one in particular was from our mutual friend, Big Jack Gordusky, who knew you back in the day. And he tells me that you, besides being a great bowler, were also a great coach. And you were getting upwards of $300 an hour for giving lessons, which back then it was about $25 was the going rate. But he said you got $300 an hour and that you could help bowlers almost immediately with some of the great tips that you had. Is all that true?
Well, you know, I knew that I did receive a lot of money from people to help them bowl. And when I did coach them, you know, sometimes it did get up to $300 an hour because it was really hard to capture somebody's interest. And if they really wanted to learn, that I would spend the time with them. And everybody that I spent, a lot of games have changed. There's a guy named Tony Rosamilia. He came to see me at Bull Right Lanes after I got sober. And he wanted to hook the ball more, and I helped him, and he had won like 6 regional titles, and I think he almost made the TV show in Carolier. But yeah, I did help people, and at times it was almost $300 an hour.
Unbelievable. Well, not only did you have the talent to throw the bowling ball, but you also had an eye for the entire game and all the techniques involved. And, you know, Bobby, we could spend hours and hours talking about all of your bowling records and accomplishments, and I wish that we had the time to do that here. But what I'm hoping for is that all of those records and accomplishments are in the book. Are they?
Well, most of them. I believe the world record doubles is in there. I broke it twice. Me winning the regional championship classic, which brought me to the Firestone Tournament of Champions. And everything, yeah. All the great accomplishments that I had to go along with the bad ones. That's in the book.
Well, I'll tell you what, to do a little research on this show with you, I did go in and I looked up your bowling record, and I got to tell you, it took up an entire page, and an entire page would take up a whole show just to list all the things you've done with the bowling ball, and I'm sure there's some things in there that weren't in there. A lot of records and accomplishments are bowled under unsanctioned conditions, and nobody knows about that but you. But what one bowling accomplishment are you the most proud? And I'm sure there's a bunch of them, but if you could just give me one, maybe two at the most.
Well, the first one would be when I struck out to bowl my first regional I ever bowled. I struck out to beat the great Ralph Hangin. And I struck out in the 10th to beat him to win it. And at that time, it was a great feat in the regional program, because all there ever was in the regional tournaments were tour champions. So that made me a PBA champion for the first time. So that's probably the first one and the one I think about the most. And the second was when I bowled in the league in New Jersey, and I averaged 266 for 66 games before the lanes changed. And of course the lanes were blocked and unreal, but the way every Thursday night I walk into the bowling alley, and Roth was there, Petraga was there, Dave Davis was there, everybody bowled in the league from the east that was great, and I led the averages by over 40 pins a game.
That sounds unbelievable, but I know it's all true. And when you mentioned beating Ralph Hangin, if some of our listeners don't know who Ralph is or was, I go way back. I'm an old timer myself, and many, many times I've talked to people from the East Coast, and back in the day, he was the best. And if you ran over Ralph like that in the 10th frame, that had to be an unbelievable accomplishment.
Oh, yeah, it was. It was. And he was rooting for me on every ball. When I threw the first strike, I just walked backwards. I didn't look at him, only because I heard him clapping. And then the next one, when I struck to win, he just jumped up and ran up at the foul line and picked me up. And that was a great time in my life, one of the best.
He was a classy guy, and boy, could he bowl. I remember him back in the day, my friend. Hey, Bob, bowling for the mob. Did writing this book cause you any problems for some of those underground people that you used to come in close contact with?
Oh, no, absolutely not. First of all, it's because they've all passed away. And second of all is the fact that it's all good what it said about them. And, if they were alive, man, I'd have 3 different partners, but it would be great, They always had a great message when they talked to people about their nephew who was a great bowler. And if they were still around, they would have loved this book.
Well, I can't wait to read it myself. You've sent me a couple of excerpts, and I'll tell you what, I still got the chills on my arms from reading some of the stuff that you sent me, and I'm going to probably be the first guy in line to buy that book when it comes out. But it's awesome. And I know that you've been sober for 21 years, and you should be very proud of that. And I also understand that you've been helping others with their drug and alcoholism addiction problems. So basically, how have you been doing that, Bob?
Well, it all started with a store my sister and I formed called Last Stop. And it was a referral service that we did for free. We put people in drug and treatment centers for free. But after 2006, when business-wise, we had to close Last Stop. First, the government made us move because the train station was a historic spot. But, you know, what I got to do is, Howard just told me that I keep my phone on 24 hours a day and I keep my battery charged. Because I go to an enormous amount of meetings and I'm always there if people need help. I basically know how to get them to treatment centers, detoxes, and I try to get them there as soon as possible. And you know, they tell me the only way I get to keep sober is to give it away. And I constantly, every day, my phone's on. I talk to 10 or 15 people a day in the program, and I'm there to help somebody, either pick them up, take them to where they got to go, or get them in the treatment center immediately. And that's really important to me. And that's one of the biggest things that I love to do, especially through the rooms in which I'm in, where I recover every day.
Well, obviously, you've had a few people help you along the way, too, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, I had the same people in my life from day one, and the only reason they left was because they had passed away, or else they'd still be here in my life. I had three men, Billy, George, and Jack. Jack and George were brothers, and they really spent their entire life for me from the day that they met me to the day that they passed away. They were in my life.
So if there's people out there listening to this and they've got an addiction problem, you highly recommend them seeking help as soon as possible, then getting a friend to help them along with it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, if people have a problem, they need to immediately get into a treatment center or a detox. With today's high-powerful drug abuse, and heroin's still alive a lot, and so is crack, that, you know, these drugs are dangerous. And you can die through withdrawal. So, you know, the first thing to do is get to the nearest detox and treatment center that you can. And then when you get involved in the program, you get yourself a sponsor or a great friend, and they will take you all through the program and teach you how to get back to society clean and sober.
That's great. You know, I see you on Facebook every day. You're either on there personally or somebody's writing something about you, and I noticed on there that you're having some health issues. So if I could be a little bit nosy and personal, how is your health, Bobby?
Well, right now I'm basically okay, but I fell into this my blood levels, and I have this infection in my blood, which we're working on really a lot right now. And they've been watching me every day. I was there this morning. They're taking blood cultures, and they're just taking the blood test to make sure my diabetes, which is bad, I'm type 1, uncontrollable because of everything, and I take care of it every day. I have doctors looking over 24 hours, and, you know, I'm having some big-time cramps in legs and arms, and it's stricken me from at night from walking. But after that, it's all nothing compared to what I had to do to get sober.
Yeah, I can imagine. You know, obviously we've all gotten a little bit older, but you were such a legend back in the day. I've had a lot of people ask me to ask you, are you ever going to bowl competitively again?
Well, this is what I say when that great article come out about me, and I won the high roller the next month. When I get healthy, and right now I am practicing, and I'm a couple months away. I will be back. I will bowl. And chances are, because of what Chuck Pisano said, that I will win again and call him up and tell him I won another tournament. So I will be bowling again. I'm sick. I'm not dead, but I will be there. Both arms, both legs, flinging it down a lane.
Wow. I'll tell you what, you've got some intestinal fortitude. I don't know if they call it guts or chops or whatever they call it, but I've never seen anybody. I'd like to have you in my foxhole if we ever got attacked, I'll tell you that.
Definitely. If there's one person that has true loyalty to friends, it's myself.
You know, on the last show, you mentioned that you're going to probably be in Vegas in January. What's going on there?
Well, I already talked to Brad Edelman, who runs the high roller tournaments. And in February, when the PAC tournament's running, Brad wants me to come and sign books. And I'm going to be probably balling and getting shaped. And Storm will be there behind my corner. And, you know, we're going to release the book there. It's the first official release, and we hope to sign a whole bunch of books for all the bowlers.
Well, you better get your wrist ready, I'll tell you. You better have a table set up down there because there's a lot of people going on. It's not the showboat anymore because the showboat's gone, but I'm sure that place is going to be packed, so you better get your wrist in shape.
No, no problem. I've already called Mike Coffin at the Boyd Group, who runs all the bowling centers. You know Mike. He's a great guy. And now it's up to Brad and Mike to get it all arranged so we can do it.
Well, Brad's one heck of a good businessman. He'll take care of it. I know that for sure.
Okay.
You know, speaking of businessmen, let's throw out a few props to a couple of your close friends that are helping you with this. Howard, give us a little bit about Howard.
Howard's a financial guru. He's highly intelligent in the field of financials, and he's a great supporter, and he's in my corner all the time. From the time that we renewed our friendship after 40 years, Howard's really the reason that the book got together, and Howard's the reason that I'm still alive. Because had I stayed in Vegas, the radiation was killing me. And I came here, and the University of Virginia has been great, and it's almost saved my life completely.
Ah, fantastic. How about Stefan?
Stefan's the author. He's a tremendous guy. He just walked in, Lenny. So he's sitting there, and, you know, we renewed this friendship. I got to meet him, and the last 18 months has been the gift of my life, and he's the person behind the whole book.
You know, you say he's the author. Is he from New York also?
No, he lives here in Charlottesville, and I believe he was from Allentown? Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Well, the reason I asked that is the excerpts that you sent me, it sounded like you were talking when he was writing.
Oh, yeah. Stefan captured my voice big time in this book. So it's great. It's great. And like you said, you were sitting there, and it was like I was sitting right next to you.
For sure. Unbelievable. I just can't understand how people can do that. There's some talent that some people have out there that's unbelievable. All right, tell us about the pretty one.
Oh, of course, Bethany Joy Carson. She's the person that we haven't been put in our lives, and all of this came about Bethany's expertise in the field of books. She's a guiding angel that had put everything together, or none of this would have came about.
Awesome. Well, Pards, I can't believe that the old clock on the wall tells me we're almost out of time, and I can't believe how fast the time flies in this show, and it's probably why they say it's the fastest show in all of sports, but I have a lot more to talk with you about and would love to have you back on Phantom Radio, let's say after the first of the year or so, for an update on how the book sales are coming along. And I enjoyed talking with you again, Bob, and I find you to be a fascinating, honest, talented guy, and I really want to thank you for taking the time to be here with us, and hopefully I'll see you again soon somewhere down the road. We got a minute or two. Anything you want to say, you got the stage, my friend.
Okay. All I can say is that this book, Bowling for the Mob, is about my life story, and it's got so many emotional ups and downs. But the bottom line is, at the end, from the streets of New York City to the top of the world again, in the world of bowling, which I started and I want to be the greatest of all time. So if you're having a problem with alcohol and drugs, read the book and it might give you some insight on how to get better. And if you want to live your dream and you're out there and you're young and you're on pro tour and you want to be famous, just dig in, use your heart, use your natural instincts, and your dream will come true. So with that, that's how I'm going to end this one, Lenny.
All right. Well, you know, libraries and bookstores are full of self-help books, and I read a lot of them in my day because doing the lanes on the tour, I had to deal with a lot of bowlers that were upset, and I had to find out about the mental game. And the mental game is totally different from the physical game. There's a lot of people out there that have a great physical game, but they got no helmet, nothing upstairs. And that's what holds them back. And I find this book to be one of the best self-help books I've ever read in my life. And as I'm sitting here speaking, I've got the chills on my arm because I'm reliving a couple of the excerpts that you sent me. And I'll tell you what, I mentioned this before the show even started. I have some tears on my keyboard here, and a couple of them are stuck because it's such a fantastic story. It's hard to believe all of it, but knowing you and knowing all the people that you know, or knowing a lot of the people that you know, I know it's all true. And my hat's off to you, Bob, not only for all your physical talents, but now for your mental game. It's the strongest I've ever seen. Congratulations.
Well, thanks a lot. The one other thing I'd like to say thank you to is Corbett Alston and Storm Bowling Company for everything that they have done for us in this book. And for what they're doing for the help of this book getting released. So.
Yeah, Storm's one of the greatest companies that there is out there in the bowling world. They've sponsored our show from day one, and I just got some bad news that one of their representatives, longtime great Hall of Fame bowler Bob Hart, had a heart attack in Las Vegas, and we wish him a speedy recovery. Bob, all of our prayers are going out to you.
All right. Yes, and my prayers went too. I read that yesterday on Facebook, that he had the heart attack. So, yeah. But Bobby Hart was a great man, and the years I won the doubles, he won the all events in the same year in the ABC.
Wow, unbelievable.
All right, Lenny, thank you for everything.
All right, well, hang on while I close the show, Pards, and mark off January or February. We're going to do this again because I still got a lot more I want to talk to you about, all right?
You got it. No problem, Lenny.
All right, well, Phantom fans, that's going to wrap up another show for this week, and I hope that you all enjoyed it and you enjoyed hearing from Bob Perry Perzicki. We look forward to talking to all of you again next week with yet another interesting guest to talk to. And don't forget to tell all your friends about our show. In closing, I'd like to thank our sponsors, EliteBowling.com, Storm Bowling Products, Stars and Strikes, America's Bowling News Magazine, TeamMastersBowling.com, and the El Dorado Hotel and Casino in Reno for bringing us to you each and every week. So for Phantom Radio, this is the Phantom.